As you see, all C and all D were not even participated. I think this is because it was apparent that these could not succeed. All C would get suckered by betrayers. All D cannot create profits by cooperation. Random was the bottom among the all participants. No plan could not survive in this race. Then Joss ranked 12th out of a total of 15 participants, including the random. Friedman could not earn a high score, ranked 7th out of 15. To the organizer's surprise, the winner was the simplest strategy, tit for tat. It ranked top out of 15. Tit for tat also attained the highest score in the second tournament. So, what can we learn from the results? Let's see the essence of Axelrod's analyses, aiming to make use of them in our daily lives. According to Axelrod, tit for tat has four essential characteristics. First, niceness. Never the first to defect. Cooperate on the first move. This nice strategy is successful because it can share gains with the opponents from repeated mutual cooperation. On the contrary, if you start with a defection, rebuilding the cooperative relations could be difficult. Tit for tat surpassed the all D strategy because the latter cannot be nice. Second, forgiveness. Even after being betrayed, this propensity allows you to let bygones be bygones and create new cooperative relations. Due to this, parties could avoid the chain of mutually destructive actions. This trait is important because mutual cooperation provides enormous benefits for both in this game. Forgiveness could be a strength. Tit for tat exceeded the Friedman because the latter cannot forgive. Third, retaliation. Once opponents have betrayed, you retaliate against them only one time. The retaliation has the merit of preventing the other's further betrayal. Tit for tat could resist against the Joss because of this propensity. Lastly, clarity. If you have a clear strategy, others could easily understand it. This clarity is beneficial for both parties because cooperation could be built quickly. The random strategy had to fall due to a lack of this element. So, based on the discussion, what is the conclusion today? If we encountered a similar situation with the prisoner's dilemma, what is the best strategy for us? Be nice at first. This strategy is essential, especially when mutual cooperation brings a huge benefit. The factor in dividing the top and the bottom group was whether it was nice or not. All strategies of the top group included the nice method. Second, if the other person cooperates, cooperate with them. Ignore the temptation to defect, because it would destroy long-term mutual benefits. If you are betrayed, then retaliate. The retaliation should be just one time, and you should see the other's next move to avoid long-term feuding. Third, don't be envious. The tit-for-tat strategy has never tried to surpass the others. It just paid attention to keep up with them. These little steps boosted the strategy to the top, while others have sometimes lost by the others' betrayal. Comparing with the others produces motivation to defect others. So, do not compare yourself with others. Lastly, don't be too clever. In the tournaments, players did not get any benefits by hiding their true intentions. On the contrary, if your strategy is easy to understand, it would increase cooperation chances. Be open to others. As with the other theories, today's discussion has some constraints. First, today's discussion is based only on computer simulations. I think this fact is the most significant constraint. This means that, even if you comply with today's lessons, there's no guarantee that you would succeed in the actual games. The reason could be differences in assumptions, lack of consideration for other variants, difficulties of quantifying the elements, or misinterpretation of situations. Second, Some argue that the discussion is too simplified. In the real world, two opponents don't have equal influences on the other, in many cases. Moreover, it is usual for more than two to be involved. The more involved, the less effective the theory becomes. For example, even if you retaliated against an opponent, it might not have enough influence, because that person might gain help from third parties. Lastly, some point out that, even if the discussion is proper, there could be difficulties for us to implement the theory. In many cases, options might not be the only two. Defecting, cheating, or betraying could not be the option sometimes. Immediate reactions themselves could be extremely difficult. More generally, being able to track the previous history with the other person is an indispensable condition. In sum, the discussion has some critical constraints. However, the theory is inspiring. And it is even ethical, because it tries to be nice and reciprocal. We could make use of it for our lives to some degree. I hope you enjoy this video. Please do not forget to subscribe. See you soon.